mom's looking very nervous. Appreciate that. We got to make a few moms cry, so that's always good. Mother's Day, the ancient roots of Mother's Day, actually go back to the Greeks and Romans who had a celebration of the mother goddesses and so forth. But in the early church, Mothering Day was actually the fourth Sunday of Lent. And it was the day that everyone was expected to go back to the first church they went to. It was so it was going back to your mother church. Where your faith was first began. But in modern times, the celebration of Mother's Day actually goes back to a lady by the name of Anne Reeves Jarvis. This is her with her daughter Anna, and then an older picture of her as well. Anne was born to a Methodist pastor and his wife in Grafton, Virginia in 1832. She married a Baptist pastor in 1850, and she actually had 11 children, but only 4 lived to become adults, which is maybe what inspired her work. Sometime in the mid-1850s, Anne began a club known as the Mother's Work Day Club. She organized a group of women who would regularly get together once a month or once every few weeks, and they would gather up medicine, and they would go around to the homes in their neighborhood, and they would teach some of the younger women about hygiene skills and how to look after babies and all those kind of things. They would gather medicine. They would feed the hungry children, and generally they would do whatever they could do to kind of reduce child mortality in Virginia. And the idea actually quickly caught on, and there were several Mother's Workday clubs that began to spring up all over the state of Virginia. And then came Civil War, and their work changed. But Virginia was kind of one of the worst places to be in the Civil War. It was a border state, so you had people in Virginia that were on both sides of the conflict, and some of the bloodiest battles took place in Virginia. And so the Mother's Work Day clubs began to care for soldiers, wounded soldiers, on either side. It didn't matter which side you fought on, they were caring for you. Then after the Civil War, these Mother's Work Day clubs became Mother's Friendship Days as they brought together mothers and soldiers from both sides of the war to try to bring some healing and some reconciliation and some unity back to the country. Well, after Anne's death in 1905, her daughter, Anna Jarvis, so the little baby picture up there, thought she needed to do something to honor her mother. And all the sacrifices that she had made, both for her children and her community. So in 1907, she held a small private celebration in her church for her mom. And then next year, she convinced her church to have a huge celebration. And she not only convinced her church in Virginia, she also convinced a store owner in Philadelphia, owned in a department store chain, to do something special for moms. And 1,000 people showed up at his store. to celebrate and honor their moms on that first Mother's Day. And it was so successful that Anna began to lobby people. She used to write letters to politicians and the newspapers saying, we ought to have a Mother's Day once a year to say thank you to all of the moms out there. And she said, too many of our American holidays are biased towards celebrating the achievements of men. So she started this letter campaign to celebrate moms. And her persistence paid off. 1914, President Woodrow Wilson proclaimed Mother's Day to always be the second Sunday in May. And almost immediately, Anna regretted what she had done when she had created. Because as soon as it became a national holiday, in all the card stores, in all the flower shops, in all the department stores, in all the restaurants, started having all these specials and making all the money and making it also commercialized, that she didn't look like anything that she wanted. She actually ended up denouncing the holiday that she had created. And she actively lobbied to repeal the legislation. What was the issue? She summed it up best when she said what she wanted was a day that we could all celebrate the best mother in the world. And the best mother in the world is your mother. And so that's why she actually called it Mother's Day, with a singular, not the plural, mother's day. It's not multiple mothers, but your mother. And her vision for this day was a day that you would go home and you would spend time with your mom. You would say thank you for everything that she had done for you. It was supposed to be a very personal, intimate moment between a mom and her children. For Anna, it became so commercial that it kind of lost that personal touch for her. But for Anna, her personal relationship with her mom kind of shaped the impact of who she was for the rest of her life. It was that enthusiasm. Or that enthusiasm that she had initially for the holiday came out of that relationship that she had with her mom and her respect for her mom. Now, I don't know if Anna had a favorite gospel, but I think if she did, it probably would have been the Gospel of John. Because John, more than any others, has personal stories of Jesus' resurrection. We have a story of Peter and John, just two of the disciples, who run to the tomb to see what has happened. We have the story of Thomas. You remember when Jesus showed up again and says to Thomas, here, touch my hands and believe, stop him. We have that wonderful story where three times Jesus says to Peter, do you love me? Feed my sheep. And of course, we also have that passage which I read this morning, the story of Mary Magdalene. In the Gospel of John, Mary Magdalene only shows up at the cross and then at the tomb. But in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, we actually learn that she is mentioned among several women who traveled with Jesus and the disciples to care for them. They were the women who kind of fed them and kept them on track and so forth. And we've learned that in their first meeting with Jesus, the first time Jesus met her, he actually cast out several demons for them. Mary had gone to the tomb early in the morning. She was among the women who first discovered that the tomb was empty, the stone was rolled away. And she ran to Peter and to John. She told them the body was gone, and they had run to the tomb and confirmed her true story, and then they walked away. But Mary came back to the tomb, slumped on the ground, just outside the entrance, began to cry. She couldn't believe what was happening. She peered into the tomb once again, only this time it wasn't empty. This time, there were two men inside, angels we learned a little bit later, but men dressed in white. And they asked her, why are you crying? They took my Lord away, and I don't know where they put him, she said. Then she turned away from him, because she wanted to hide her tears. She didn't want them to see her crying. And she discovered as she turned back the other way, there was another, a third man there. And he spoke, woman, why are you crying? She didn't really look at him. She thought he was the gardener. Tell me where he is and I will get him. I don't know what she thought she was going to do. I mean, if it had already been stolen once, then you think it would be stolen again. But Was she even big enough to carry a body? Would it be too much for her? I don't think those thoughts really crossed her mind, but still, she wanted to know. Overwhelmed with grief, she turned away from him again to hide her tears, and then she heard his voice speak her name. Mary. She recognized the sound of the radio. Rabboni, she called. Teacher. She grabbed a hold of him with all of her might. She wasn't going to lose him again. Never again was he going to be away from her. It's a famous, actually, painting of this story done by a guy by the name Giotto. I should get Fran Brown to form it. Italian love. Giotto, the long man, it's a painting of Jesus and Mary Magdalene that he did around 1320. And you see in the picture, Jesus holding his hand up, trying to keep Mary away while she has her hands extended up, pleading with him to not leave her again. It almost looks like Jesus is walking away from her. That as if he's trying to say, don't hold me back, I've got important work to do, more important work to do. I think that's what a lot of people think of when they see Jesus' words, when he says, don't hold on to me, I've not yet ascended to my Father. But I actually don't think Giotto got it correct. I think Austin Miles actually probably got it a little bit closer. Remember the song, In the Garden? It's also about this moment of meeting Mary Magdalene in the garden. And the chorus of that song says, he walks with me and he talks with me, tells me that I am his own. Joy we share as we tarry there and another has ever known. I'd like to think that Jesus let Mary hold on to him for a few moments. And then he said, you can stop clinging to me now. I'm not leaving right away. I'm not ascending to my Father right away. I need to go tell others the good news as well as the fact that I'm going back to be with the Father. And she did. She runs back, she tells the other disciples. I've seen the Lord. I've seen him. John tells us that she told everything that Jesus had said. But why was it important for Jesus to say, I'm ascending to the Father and to your Father, to let the disciples know that? It's a signal, I think, to the disciples and to Mary that things are about to change. Jesus is alive. That did not mean that things were going to go back the way they were. It wasn't going to be just like it had been before the crucifixion. In fact, with the crucifixion and now the resurrection, all these things change. Jesus had actually warned them about this. Last night in the upper room, Jesus told them after he left, after his death, after his resurrection, after he left, that he would actually send to them another, an advocate, he said, to be helpful to you, a comforter to be with you, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit who would be with them and enable them to have an even closer relationship with God. Even closer than having his physical presence there. That Jesus was going to stick around for a few weeks, but things were going to change. They were going to change in a good way. As I mentioned, we have been working our way through the story. We have been going from Genesis to Revelation. If you can remember all the way back to chapter 1, you'll remember that. In that first garden, God was able to walk and talk with Adam and Eve, the first man and woman. There was a close relationship between them until they chose to break it. And then the rest of Scripture is the story of God seeking to bring us back to that place where we can have that close relationship with Christ. But Jesus' death and Jesus' resurrection makes that possible for us. This morning, as we remember the resurrection, it's the most significant step forward in the story. Mary's testimony is the perfect example of what it's all about. What did she say? I have seen the Lord. I've met him. I've touched him. I've talked with him. And she reminds us that Christianity is not about, it's not knowing about Jesus. It's knowing Jesus. But a relationship with Christ. But Christianity is not reading and singing about Jesus. It's about meeting, having an experience of Christ that leaves us with a certainty investment, that part of her life, into creating a celebration of that close relationship that can exist between a mom and her children. Because she wanted everyone to have that good relationship with her mom. I feel sad that later in life, things kind of went off the rails for her. The first half of her story is kind of like that experience of marriage. There was a joy that she couldn't keep to herself, that she had to share the news that Jesus is alive. We who know Jesus today, we who have experienced a relationship with Christ, we too have been told by Jesus to go and share. But Jesus still told Mary, go tell the disciples, has told us to go share with our neighbors, share with our friends, share with our family, so they can have that same experience of Christ. You have an amazing Savior. We have a Savior who is alive today and who is among us. We have a Savior whose life is so grand that he wants to share with us. So let's never be slow to celebrate that, be able to share that with others. Let us be as excited about our relationship with Christ as we are about our relationships with our friends. Let's brag about Christ as much as we would brag about God. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, close.